We're going to continue our series, amen? We're going to see if we can get through it today. But how many knows that we go according to what the Holy Ghost wants?
Yes.
Hallelujah. How many knows what we're teaching right now? We're teaching out with the old and with the new. We're talking about the old covenant versus the new covenant. Why Jesus Christ had to come and die on the cross. What was Jesus' mission? Why did he have to come to the earth and die on the cross? Amen?
Amen.
Did he come to abolish the law? Did he come to do away with the Ten Commandments? Now, how many knows that this is a teaching ministry?
Amen.
Amen. That means that you're going to have to do a little bit of studying during the week.
Oh,
I got to get into the Bible. If you don't get into the Bible, we were in a ministry for quite some time. My wife and I and some others that were in here. And the minister of that church used to tell us that if you don't read your word, when you come in here, you're going to drown. I never really understood what he was talking about until I started attending the church. Because the teaching was so heavy, how many knows if you go to school and you don't study, and they start teaching, you're going to be completely lost.
Amen.
How many knows when you're studying the Word of God, you come in here, you're going to hear the very same thing come over you, and you're going to be able to enter in and stay afloat.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I began to study the Word of God and began to get in the church house and begin to understand what was coming behind the pulpit.
Amen.
But I didn't study the Word of God. How many knows that when we first enter into Christianity, we just don't start picking up the Bible and start reading 4 or 5 chapters? Amen.
Amen.
We may read 4 or 5 scriptures, and that may be once a week.
Yeah.
By the time you get here on Sunday, we start teaching you these very things, and then you're totally lost. Hallelujah. But there's a good thing for you who just got here. Keep doing what you know to do. Amen?
Amen.
Keep reading your word. Keep praying. Keep studying the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
And God will start to give you more. Hallelujah.
That's right.
Amen.
We're talking about all, out with the old and with the new. Let's go to Hebrews. Everybody go with me. Hebrews chapter 10. We're going to continue the series. I'm going to do a little refreshing for some of y'all that weren't here last Sunday. Y'all are going to enjoy the rest of this message. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to start at chapter 9, verse 13 through 28. And this is the foundation for Christianity. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
You're going to understand why that a lot of what's going on behind the pulpit and a lot of ministry that's happening right now in these last days that they're talking about faith, grace, grace, grace. We're no longer under the law, but we're under grace. Amen?
Amen.
Has anybody heard that message from behind the pulpit? You turn on Christianity, it's everywhere right now. It's spreading like cancer, I said last Sunday.
Yes.
That tells the believer what? That I can go into the church house and that I don't have to abide by a set of laws in order to be accepted by Christ. That's half true. Okay, I want you to stay with me. When you come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you receive salvation and you're born again, you understand why Jesus died, that you were born into the earth with sin because of what Adam and Eve did. Now we all have that bloodline all the way from our ancestors. Amen? None of us were here. We're born by the Spirit. We weren't conceived by the Holy Ghost. Amen? So we were not perfect when we were born into the world. How many know that?
Amen.
When we first came into the world, what was the first thing we did? Wham! When a baby comes into the earth, what's the first thing they do? They cry.
That's right.
Why? It's all about me already. We're born with that selfish tendency. We're born with that dead part of ourselves. Amen? We are not born into the earth resurrected. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We are born into the earth with a carnal state. That's our flesh part. Amen?
Amen?
Because of the fall of man, sinful bodies we live in, that's why we all die. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But when we die, as being believers in the Lord, we go where? Straight to heaven. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody with me? So when we receive Christ, did we all have to follow a set of rules before we receive salvation? No. All we simply had to do was believe by faith in what Christ did at the cross, and then we were saved, sanctified, given the Holy Spirit, and born again, transformed. So you don't have to do anything. I don't want you to misunderstand what the pastor is saying today. When you receive salvation, you don't have to do anything but except believe upon the blood of Jesus that was shed for you at Calvary so that you can receive the Holy Ghost and salvation. You're saved. Saved from what? The day of judgment.
Hallelujah.
All of us are saved from that terrible day that shall come upon the earth. The end times. Everybody with me?
Amen.
And that hope we have our hope in Christ Jesus. What? The hope of the resurrection. The hope of the rapture. Knowing that us are not going to be left behind to experience the terrible fate that's going to come upon the earth. That is our hope in Christ Jesus. Though we have to go through a few things while we're in the earth, the Bible says. How many have been going through a bit of trials this week?
Amen.
Amen.
Maybe
Amen.
Some heavier trials than usual. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The higher you go up in God, the more the trials seem to come. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's okay though. Many are the trials, Jesus said, we must face before what? Entering into heaven. You're like, I don't understand. I might as well go back to the world. I'm going through these many trials. I might as well be in the world and ease my pain with a bit of alcohol, with a bit of drugs, with a bit of partners. Amen?
Amen.
This is the same thing I was experiencing in the world that I'm experiencing Christianity. How many know that's a lie from the pit of hell?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The only thing now, Christian, is that your eyes have been opened to your mess. You didn't see the mess before because you were in a what? In a deadened state.
Amen.
Your spirit man wasn't resurrected. So you weren't aware of your surroundings. When you're born again, you're given the Holy Ghost, the light is turned on. Now you have a flashlight to see all the mess in your life. Like, whoa, I am a mess. Amen. I need the grace of God.
Amen.
I need the mercy of God. If you're sitting here today saying, I'm starting to feel you, starting to come alive now a little bit. Some of y'all during the week have gone to sleep. Don't fall asleep. Because when you fall asleep, what happens? The flesh becomes heavy. And your flesh will start to dominate your will. The flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. Everyone in here have a willing spirit. Everybody in here loves the Lord. But if you start to back up from studying, from praying, from ministry, the flesh will begin to what? Energize, come alive. You'll start to see yourself, your fleshly thoughts begin to dominate you. Amen?
Amen.
Those who are in the flesh cannot what? Please God. Those who are in the Spirit, think about those things that please the Spirit of God. How do you get to that place? You reside in the Holy of Holies.
That's right.
This was locked up. We couldn't get into the Holy of Holies. This is the tabernacle in the wilderness. We're talking about out with the old, in with the new. Amen?
Amen.
Come on now.
Hallelujah.
Out with the old, in with the new. This is what Moses led them out of Egypt, took them into the wilderness. This is Moses' tabernacle. Where did Moses get the diagram for all of this to take place? He got it upon the mountain when we went up on the mountain, remember? He didn't come down and turn white like that in the movie, okay? He had the white hair and the white beard because he was in the holiness of God. Though sometimes we feel like something has happened when we went into the Holy of Holies, right? Something should happen every time you go into the presence of God. That's why we tell y'all to spend time in God. Because of what you're not getting here, you go when you get it in private time.
Amen.
You come here to learn. Then you apply it out there. This has been barred in the wilderness. Everybody with me?
Yes.
Okay? And Moses led them out. I'm getting excited. Moses led them out of Egypt. Okay? They were bound for 400 years in Egypt. He led them out. Moses got the diagram for the tabernacle upon the mountain. It wasn't just the Ten Commandments. He was up there 40 days and 40 nights. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
He was up there so long. What were the other people? The other people that he led out of Egypt were down there. He was gone so long, they didn't hear from God. Because Moses was the mediator at that time for the people.
Amen.
Amen. So he was up on the mountain. Here he is. He led them out in the wilderness. And he's gone 40 days and 40 nights. He's getting all this together for the people. You know, and the people, what they start doing? They started partying. They started creating idols. They started complaining and murmuring. Where is this Moses? Where is our God? He led us out here to die. We might as well go back to Egypt. Doesn't that sound like us today? Because God didn't answer today. He didn't answer yesterday. He didn't answer 5 minutes when I prayed afterwards. Sometimes it takes a little bit of walking out in faith. Those who wait upon the Lord, he shall what? renew your strength like the eagle's wings, and you shall soar high above the mountaintop, high above your problems. Amen? But sometimes there's a waiting period. How many knows what waiting means? It doesn't mean sitting in the pew and waiting. You ever been to a restaurant? Who's been in a restaurant here? Waiting. This is what a waiter does. He waits on someone. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You continually do what you know to do while you're waiting for your miracle. Don't start complaining. Don't start murmuring. Where's my God? He hasn't come quick enough. I'm going to go ahead and start going partying. I'm going to start going back into the... I might as well go back to Egypt. I might as well go back to the world. God isn't answering fast enough. I'm done with this thing. I'm done with church. I mean, you know, that's a lie from the pit of hell.
Amen.
Amen. And on the mountain, when Moses went up there, Moses was commanded by God that nothing was to touch that mountain because it was holy unto God. Not no animal, no man can come and touch the mountain or they would die because of the holiness of God. Amen? Because the animals and men was defiled. They couldn't touch. We needed something to replace that, which was anger towards sin. And here we go. The tabernacle that was set up in the wilderness. Let's go.
Amen.
We're going to get a little more into the tabernacle, and I'll show you a little more. We'll go into it.
Amen.
That's the foundation of Christianity, saints. What is it, this old covenant? What was it all about? No one teaches it. Why? Because it's boring. I wish you would tell us something that's so exciting. Deliverance, healing, money, something. How many knows? This is your whole foundation. Why? Because all of this points to what?
Christ.
To Christ.
Amen.
To our Savior. Why was this system set up in the wilderness to teach people that there had to be a shedding of blood, there had to be a sacrifice
Amen.
To atone for what? For God. Sin. Amen? God did the first atoning with Adam and Eve when He covered them with animals, clothed them,
Amen.
And shed the blood. Why? Because life is in the blood. Blood has to be given for blood. But animals couldn't do it because it wasn't good enough. It had to be someone come to the earth to do it for us,
Hallelujah.
Which was Christ Jesus. That's our foundation. Amen?
Amen.
That's why we understand why now I understand why Christ had to come. This is all a type and shadow, the tabernacle of what was going on in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
So Moses just didn't receive 10 commandments when he came down from the mountain. He's got white hair, white beard, and he's holding 10 commandments. That's Hollywood. Hallelujah. There's no place in Scripture where it says his beard turned white or his hair turned white because of the glory of God. Amen? No. If anything, he came down and the glory shone upon his face. Was shining upon his face.
Hallelujah.
And he put a veil over it. Why? Because the glory was already fading. Because only a coming upon in the Old Testament. The Holy Ghost and the anointing of God only came upon certain ones to do certain things. Today we have the indwelling of the Holy Ghost
yes.
because of what Jesus Christ
Amen.
Did. Now we're transformed from the inside, not from the outside. Amen?
Amen.
All this is external in use. Amen? First of all, we couldn't even get into the Holy of Holies where God was. This is the Holy of Holies, and there was a veil that separated the Holy of Holies. And here's the holy place, and here's the outer courts. Okay, let's go.
Amen.
All right, let's go. Are we there? I'll see if I need to lay any more foundation or refresh. That's all the Holy Ghost. For y'all that have born here last Sunday, that's a crash course.
Okay?
Just threw you in there to kind of rebuild from last Sunday. That way you can kind of catch up so you won't be completely lost. How many know that's mercy and grace?
All right, here we go.
Because some of y'all have things that y'all got to do, work and things like that. God understands. Amen? Verse 13, are we there? Hebrews chapter 9. Under the old system. What old system are they talking about? This old system is what they're talking about. Not the Ten Commandments. That old system is talking about a system of ceremonial things that the high priest and the priest had to do, which went through the Levitical priest. Amen? Everybody
Amen.
Understand that? Okay, let's keep going. It says, under the old system, the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a young cow could clean people's bodies from ceremonial impurity. That means it only cleans the outside of that person. When they sin in the past, in the Old Testament, how many knows all Old Testament? This is all New Testament. But how many knows Jesus is saying yesterday, today, and forevermore? And I'm going to explain that in a minute. Hallelujah. When the brazen altar here is where they would come and do their regular sinned. Like if someone in the community missed it, they would come and offer their bull, cow, whatever, and then they shed it on the altar here so that they could be ceremonially cleansed, that they could participate in certain Jewish customs at that time. If they were defiled in any way, they were not able to celebrate any of the Jewish customs. They were excommunicated, kept away from certain things in the community. Everybody understand that? So as an individual, they had to come to the gate, and they had, and the little priest was walking around here all the time. Amen. The priest was here. They would come. The person would come. Give them their offering. Hey, I missed it here and I sinned. So I got to give you my offering. He would do it here. In here, when the high priest, he came into the Holy of Holies only once a year. For the sins of the whole nation as a whole. Everybody understand that?
Amen.
Jesus went into the Holy of Holies and died for the world.
Amen. Amen.
That's why we're all included. This was just for the Jews. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But he came and sought that which was lost. Those who weren't part of the olive tree, but we were a part of a wild olive tree. All of us here, Gentiles by nation. No one here is Jewish. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
So we don't celebrate the Sabbath and get caught up in all that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. There are some people that still do that. I'm Jewish because I'm born again. No, you're not. You're still Hispanic. Amen. Come on now. Verse 14. You still like tortillas and beans and no, you're not Jewish. No. Amen. No. Hallelujah. Verse 14. Are we there? Just think how much more the blood of Christ will purify what? Our consciences from sinful deeds so that we can worship the living God. How many knows that the blood of bulls and goats can only cleanse us outside? It couldn't cleanse us eternally. That's why when you come to the house of God, we have the privilege of raising our hands up now without wrath or without anger. Because when we ask for Jesus Christ's blood to wash us, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, he wipes away our conscious mind from what? Sin, guilt, shame, condemnation. What you did yesterday can be cleansed today. Only simply by applying the blood of Christ. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Once you receive salvation, is that it? There's no more need for repentance. Repentance is a lifestyle for the saint, but it's not something you repent every day of the same thing. Then you got to check your walk, okay? Maybe there's something kind of missing there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You may be struggling somewhere. Maybe you're coming out of something. But how many knows that it's just not a one-time repentance? Repentance opens the way for salvation to come first. And then afterwards, if you miss it, then you continually apply that blood. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But you don't have to go and do this. Amen? That system has been taken away, and we're going to see why. For by the power of the eternal Spirit, the Holy Ghost, Christ offered himself to God as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. Everybody see that? That is why he is the one, Jesus, who mediates a new covenant between God and people, so that all who are called can receive the eternal inheritance God has promised them. Well, what is the inheritance for the saint? Jesus Christ, he died on the cross.
Amen.
He went, seated at the right hand of God, our high priest, went into a tabernacle, not made by human hands. Amen?
Amen.
But only the one that was made in heaven. Jesus went in, sprinkled the blood everywhere, and he sat down at the right hand of the Father. Why did he sit down? Because he was done. He didn't have to stay up like the high priest that offered the sacrifice every year. He had to stay active. The priesthood is done. Jesus died once for all. He doesn't have to do it again.
Amen.
Amen.
Everybody getting that?
Yeah.
For Christ died to set them free from the penalty of the sins that they had committed under that first covenant. Keep going. Verse 16. Now when someone leaves a will, it is necessary to prove that that person who made it is dead. The will goes into effect only after the person's death. While the person who made it is still alive, the will cannot be put into effect. That is why even the first covenant was put into effect with what? The blood of an animal. For after Moses had read each of God's commandments to all the people, he took the blood of calves and goats along with water and sprinkled both the book of God's law and all the people using hyssop branches and scarlet wool. Let's keep going because this is self-explanatory. Then he said, this blood confirms confirms the covenant God has made with you. And in the same way, he sprinkled blood on the tabernacle and on everything used for worship. In fact, according to the law of Moses, what law is he talking about? The ceremonial law. Everybody got that? Let's keep going. Nearly everything was purified with blood. For without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's keep going. That is why the tabernacle and everything in it, which were what? Copies of things in heaven, had to be purified by the blood of animals. But the real things in heaven had to be what? Purified with a far better sacrifice than the blood of animals. Are we there?
Amen.
Let's keep going. For Christ did not enter into a holy place, right here, holy place, made with what? With human hands, which was only a copy of the true one in heaven. This is all a type and shadow of what Jesus, they were pointing to Jesus Christ and the coming Messiah. Amen?
Amen.
Let's keep going. It says here, he entered into heaven itself, Jesus did, to appear now before God on our behalf. And he did not enter into heaven to offer himself what? Again and again. Like the high priest here on earth who enters the most holy place year after year with the blood of an animal. If that had been necessary, Christ would have had to die again and again ever since the world began. But now, once for all, he appeared at the end of the age to remove sin by his own death as a sacrifice. Let's keep reading. And just as each person is destined to die once, and after that comes judgment, so also Christ died once for all time as a sacrifice to take away the sins of many people. He will come again, not to deal with our sins, but to bring salvation to all who eagerly are waiting for him.
Amen.
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 Amen. That's not even the chapter. We're not even starting yet. So let's put that to the side here.
Amen.
I want to make sure and take it slow when I'm teaching this particular subject. Talking about out with the old and in with the new. So that we, as a Christian believer, have a strong foundation. So that no matter what comes into the Christian's life, you will not be tossed to and fro with every what? Wind of doctrine. For there are many that are coming and saying that the Old Testament is done away with. No, Jesus didn't come to abolish the law. He came to fulfill the law. What law did Jesus come to fulfill? This law. The ceremonial law that was established in the wilderness.
Amen.
So the Ten Commandments are still what? Active. That's called the moral law. That's what shows us what we're missing. Amen?
Amen.
Thou shalt not die. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not have any false idolatries before me. Amen? How many knows we can't fulfill that without Christ, though? Jesus came and fulfilled it all. Chapter 10, are we there? Now, this is where I want to start. It says, the old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow, a dim preview of the good things to come. Not the good things themselves. The sacrifices under that system were repeated again and again, year after year. But they were never able to provide perfect cleansing for those who came to worship. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's keep going. If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped. For the worshipers would have been purified once for all time, and their feelings of guilt would have disappeared. The Old Testament, this right here, no matter what, the high priest went into the Holy of Holies, even though he took the blood of the bull and animal and sacrificed it on the altar for the sin of the nation, it still did not cleanse the conscious minds of men. They were still reminded about how sinful they were. That's why the blood of bulls and goats was not good enough. It had to be a better sacrifice. That's why when Jesus died, he cleansed the consciences of men through the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Washes and cleanses us from all unrighteousness, blotting out the stains of our transgressions. Amen?
Amen?
Now we can worship God freely without having our consciences bothering us.
Amen.
Amen? Amen. Come on now. Amen. Verse 3. But instead, those sacrifices actually, what? Reminded them of their sins year after year, how sinful they were. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. That is why when Christ came into the world, he said to God, you do not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings, but you have given me a body to offer. There it is. You were not pleased with burnt offerings or other offerings for sin. Then I said, look, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written about me in the scriptures. All the scriptures pointed to the coming Messiah.
Amen.
And when Jesus came among the Pharisees and Sadducees, the Pharisees and the Sadducees missed why Jesus Christ had come. Hallelujah. The very Messiah, the very one they were waiting for, was among them, and they missed it. Why? Because they were worried about what? This. They were still worried about doing external, ceremonial things to be accepted by God. Jesus came to bring a new way. But the Pharisees still wanted to hold on to those religious traditions.
Amen.
Hallelujah. How many knows that's some of the hardest stuff to break off people when they come to the body of Christ?
Amen.
Especially Catholics and other ones. Because we come from such a ritual, routine, ceremonial type religion.
Amen.
Everybody, I can say that because I was Catholic. Amen. You go in there, confess your sins. Well, they've got it a little bit confused. They are acting as a high priest. They're acting as a priest, a mediator.
Yeah.
They're doing what this is. You can't come to God because you have to come through me, the priest, before you can talk to God. So you go in the booth, you confess your sins, and supposedly he has a connection with God. That's been done away with. That wasn't even for the Catholics or the Romans. That was for the Jews. Hallelujah. It's all misunderstood. And there's only one mediator, Jesus Christ, not Mary. We don't pray to Mary or the saints or any other little bitty monito that you have in your house. Those statues, or you burn your candle. All that stuff is witchcraft. How many knows that?
Amen.
Because you're putting up an idol. Maybe you did it in ignorance. Ignorance doesn't mean you're dumb. It means ignoring. The fact that what the Word of God says for the first time, you Christians are getting into the Word, seeing it for yourself, what the Bible says, word for word, so that you're not misled. By whom? By man's traditions. Hallelujah.
Amen.
By the time Jesus came on the scene, it had been 400 years that already had passed. So when Jesus came on the scene, how many knows there were so many man-made traditions that they had added to the law? And Jesus, they were so concerned about the washing of hands, making sure everything was so neat and put together on the outside. But he told them, inside, you're dead. All you want to do is come and do all your religious ceremonies to make people think you're holy. But you're not holy.
Amen.
You're not a part of any of this. You come in, you can sit in this church, and you can die.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh my gosh, Pastor. Why? Because you have to enter in to what? The Holy of Holies.
Amen.
Don't be on the outer court hanging out. Enter in through whom? The blood of Jesus.
Amen.
That's why we come together as a corporate body. Are you listening to me?
Amen.
You come into a corporate body. Why? So you can worship together as a corporate body. There's strength when you come together.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's why the Bible says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves as such have, and they have departed. We
Amen.
Encourage one another.
Amen.
Amen.
Here it says, go back. You see where it says 10? Go to verse 28 on chapter 9. I want to read something. The Lord, we are not going to get through this. I'm trying to jam this all down. There's a lot of meat going over you guys, all right? So take it easy, okay? If you're starting to yawn, it's not, the Lord shows me it's not that you're getting tired. The Lord shows me that your flesh is taking the beating right now. It's good. It's going over you. It's going to get into you. How many knows the Word of God is going to work on some of you? It's like a chisel, chiseling away those rocky areas. Amen. And it's been doing that for everybody in the body of Christ. Do you think my wife and I are exempt from this type of procedure? Not at all. If anything, we get it the most.
Yeah.
We're on the front lines. That's why we tell y'all, pray for us.
Yeah.
Because we are on the front lines ministering. Amen.
Amen.
The enemy's going to go after the head of those ministries. Hallelujah.
Right.
So keep those ministries in prayer. Yeah. Because we are in the last day. The Bible says in the last day, it's going to be difficult times to serve God. Why? Because sexual morality is running rampant. As soon as you go out, you're going to have some form of sex presented to you today. Because that's the society we live in. It's
right.
Accepted. Alternate lifestyles accepted. Gay marriage is accepted. Lesbianism accepted. Amen? It's not accepted.
No.
Hallelujah. It's not normal either.
Amen.
When a little child, they come up and say, well, I was born this way. They weren't born that way. That is a demonic spirit that got a hold of that child.
That's right.
Amen. Amen? How many knows that?
Amen.
Come on now. Well, I didn't start off like that. At age 18, I just began to like men, or I began to infatuate with women. Women, women, men, and men. That's what the Bible says in the last days. No, something came in on that individual.
Right.
It's all You can distinguish it between homosexuality, lesbianism, whatever. It's all foundation comes from where? Sexual perversion. So you don't say, well, you're this or you're that. You don't get caught up in all that. It all comes from one place, sexual perversion. If you stay in pornography long enough, it will go somewhere else that you don't want it to go. Amen? You may have not started off looking at men, looking at women. All of a sudden, after years of looking at it, it doesn't work anymore. Now you want to look at men. Because it's sexually perverted the foundation. That's why most... Come on now.
Get off subject.
But it's normal. It's normal. They tell you to come out. That way you're accepted. So you don't have any tormenting things. Our society accepts homosexualities now. Amen? Amen. I don't know who needs to hear this, but somebody needs to hear this. Hallelujah. Because I did not come in here trying to preach on homosexuality. Hallelujah. Woo! Praise God. Because you got to understand where it comes from. You're like, well, I'm not gay. I'm not homosexual. I don't think about those things. No. You may have not started that way, saint. Amen? Or anybody. It may have started just from looking online, pornography, and then it goes to somewhere else. How many knows who was the man that went off and killed all those? Ted Bundy.
Serial killer.
Okay? He started off looking at pornography. In his heart and mind, I really doubt he thought it was going to lead to murder. Amen? Sin will always begot other sin. It'll give birth to other sin. So cut it off at the head, saint, before it gets to a place you can't control it no more.
Amen.
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 Same thing with alcohol. Same thing with drugs. Same thing with that weed smoking. You started off smoking weed. You didn't think you'd be on crack or cocaine or heroin. You're smoking weed. Oh, it doesn't hurt me. How many knows it's still a sin onto your body?
Amen.
You don't know what you're doing to your body or what you're opening yourself up to. You smoke a little toke here. All of a sudden, you need a little coke there.
Amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
Because it doesn't give you enough anymore. Sin, flesh always wants more and more and more. And it takes and it takes and it takes. It'll never satisfy you, saint. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The only one that satisfies you and leaves you satisfied is being in the presence of our holy God. In the Holy of Holies.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you're lacking somewhere in your walk today, during the week, you start feeling that emptiness, go into the Holy of Holies,
Amen,
where Christ and God live. And begin to ask for filling.
Amen.
Fill me, O Lord. Let me come and drink of the rivers of living water and taste of your goodness one more time. For in your presence is fullness of life and fullness of power. He said, I will not leave you thirsting or hungering. When you leave out of there, you're going to be filled and satisfied.
Yes.
But you got to go in there yourself. We can't do all the feeding for you. You got to feed yourself.
Amen.
We'll feed you what we got here. Got to keep eating, all right? Stay healthy.
Amen.
Verse 8. For first Christ said, you did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings or burnt offerings or other offerings for sin. Nor were you pleased with them, though they are required by what?
The law
of Moses. Go with Matthew 17:8-9. Oh, I'm sorry, Matthew 5, verse 17. Chapter 5, verse 17. How many getting some out of this?
Amen.
Amen. We're teaching ministry. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Now we just read, I'll read it for you. You can stay in Matthew 5, 17. We just read in verse 8 and 9 that it said that though they are required by the law of Moses, then he said, look, I have come to do your will. This is Jesus speaking. Amen? So go with me to Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Are we there?
Amen.
He says, don't misunderstand. This is Jesus talking in red. Don't misunderstand why I have come, saint. I did not come to what?
Abolish
the law. That means that nothing's been done away with. Okay? So these preachers that are saying the Ten Commandments, they're done away with. They are teaching erroneous doctrine. Hallelujah.
Amen.
First of all, they don't have doctor behind their name. Most likely, they didn't go to Bible college to learn these things. They just got up there because maybe they prayed for someone, they had success.
Amen.
Y'all get that on the way home.
What?
Verse 17, are we there? Don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of who? Of Moses. Or what? The writings of the prophets. What writings is he talking about? He's talking about everything that Old Testament, that everything that pointed to the sacrificial offering that Christ had to come and replace. This wasn't cutting it, saint. This wasn't doing it. It didn't give people strength to be able to fulfill the law. Everybody go with me to Romans 8. Hold on for a second. Verse 17, it says, no. After the writings of the prophets, it says, no. Jesus said, no. I didn't come to abolish the law. No. I didn't come to do away with the law. No. I came to what? To accomplish their purpose. What purpose is he talking about? The sacrificial offering. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Go to Romans 8 real quick. Now we're doing some Bible drills. I know y'all like to move around a little bit. Are we there? Verse 3. You are going to love this. This is, what is chapter 8, the title of it say in your book?
Life in the Spirit.
Life in the Spirit. God has provided a different way. You cannot do it. No matter what, you are not able to fulfill the Ten Commandments. Let me let you know. Unless it's by what? By the Spirit. You have to do all things through Christ, which strengthens you, saint. The man who was crippled and was sitting and waiting to go in the water, and he says, do you want to be healed? And he told the man, I want to go in, but no one's here to help me. Mm-hmm. He says, I can't. We can't do it. Saint, amen? None of us in here are able to fulfill. That's why Christ came to fulfill that which we couldn't do. So our hope is in Christ Jesus. When we miss it, we come to the Father and say, Lord, I missed it today. But I come through the blood of Jesus that was sacrificed on my behalf. A better covenant established on better promises. Amen?
Amen?
Mercy and grace came by the way of Jesus Christ. When they sinned in the Old Testament, if they didn't do certain things, they were taken out of the little area and were taken out in stone, killed. That was God's command for the people to keep the nation of Israel whole. Hallelujah?
Amen.
That's not the kind of God we serve now. Judgment that was for the Old Testament. You see all the judgment in the Old Testament. For you who like to read the Old Testament, don't get so caught up. For you new believers, stay in the New Testament for a while so you understand the New Testament God. Amen.
Amen.
The Old Testament judgment was on everything. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because God was angry with sin. Animals couldn't pacify the anger God had against sin. Jesus came and pacified it. So he said, God was like, I can wait now unto a coming day when judgment shall come upon the earth. Until then, Christ is the mediator for us.
Amen.
It pleased God. It satisfied the anger that God had against sin. That's the way it is in our lives. We're getting angry. I don't understand why we're so angry. Some of y'all get so angry. Come on now, y'all listen.
Amen.
To me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because of what? Because of sin. Because why? You're out of function. You're out of fellowship somewhere.
Amen.
You're trying to do it your way. You're trying to do it in your will. You're still trying to hold on to some old things still. And when you start getting rid of them, God starts to go to work on your heart. What happens? It doesn't feel good, saint. Amen?
Amen?
That's the sanctifying process through the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Hold on with everything you got. Amen?
Amen?
Let's go to verse chapter 8, verse 3. Are we there?
Amen.
So we start to understand why Jesus had to come. Y'all are going to love this. The law of Moses, what law? This law, not the Ten Commandments, was unable to save us because of what? The weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. The law could not save us, saint. Amen? Because it was not good enough. The sacrifice wasn't good enough to save us.
Amen.
That's why when the Old Testament saints died, they didn't go into heaven automatically. They went into the lower parts. And they were held in a compartment until the day when the Messiah would show up and die on the cross. Then they were able to enter heaven.
Amen.
So when we die, we don't go into the lower parts of the earth. We go straight to heaven because of Christ.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on now.
Amen.
Woo! Okay. Praise Jesus. A little breather. Ashley. So God did what the law could not do. He sent what? His own Son in a body like the bodies we sinner have. It's in likeness of us, but he did not have sinful flesh, saint. Okay?
Amen.
Amen.
He was pure. Why? Because he was born by the Spirit. He didn't come into the earth through the seed of man. So there was nothing corrupt in him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But he was still in likeness like us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because he
Amen.
Came through the what? The womb of a woman. Come on, man.
Hallelujah.
Woo!
Hallelujah.
That's our Savior right there. And it says here, and he sent his own son in a body, the body that we sent. And in that body, God declared an end to what? To sin's control over us by giving his son as what? A sacrifice for our sins. He did this so the what? Just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us who no longer follow our sinful nature but instead follow the Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. You can't fulfill what God calls you to fulfill except through what? The Spirit of God. If you walk in the Spirit, you won't fulfill what? The lust of the flesh. Hallelujah. Let's keep going. Go back to me to Hebrews chapter 9. We're almost there. This is going to be a three-part, definitely. There's no way, because you guys, I can tell you, are getting full fast. It's a lot of word. This is heavy teaching. That's why a lot of people don't like to teach it. But I want to give you all a strong foundation in Christianity, because you're going to understand what all this means. We no longer have this. This is outdated. It's completely gone. It's obsolete because Jesus came. Amen?
Amen?
There's a new system that's been put in action now. What Jesus Christ did, we no longer have to do certain sacrificial offerings. We no longer have to do external. Amen? In order to be pleasing to God. We believe on the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah? That's what makes us acceptable. That's what allows us to go into the Holy of Holies. Hallelujah?
Amen.
The high priest, before he went to the Holy of Holies, he had to atone for his own sin. First, put blood upon him. Then he went in and sprinkled the mercy seat with the blood of the animal. Same thing we do. Hallelujah. We go through into the Holy of Holies with the blood of Jesus. So when you go into the presence of God and start demanding your way, and you don't understand why, because there's somewhere that you have to get in line with God. You first repent before going into the presence of the Holy God. Just like the priest did, high priest. How many knows that we are all high priests? Not high priests, but priests. Amen?
Amen.
Said the priestly nation, right? Come
Amen.
On now. We only have one high priest. That's Jesus Christ. Okay. Then he said, verse 9. Are we there? Chapter 10, verse 9, Hebrews. I'll wait till y'all get there.
Yes.
Then he said, look, I have come to do your will, Father. Jesus said, he cancels what? The first covenant in order to put the second into effect. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I would agree with you. It's life application. If you don't have this one, I encourage you to get one. This right here breaks down the New Testament. For the New Testament, New Living Translation is New Living Translation commentary. This commentary is amazing. Hallelujah. Now, I want you just to listen. I said, if you don't really study the Scripture, it can almost seem like he cancels the first covenant in order to put the second into effect. It almost looks like he says, he cancels all of the Old Testament in order to put the New Testament into effect. Doesn't it almost read like that?
Yes.
Now listen to me, Saint. I want you to open up your ears. It's not in Scripture. I'm going to read from the commentary. So listen real carefully with your spirit. These two verses that we just read repeat the ideas, reinforcing the contrast between the old way and the new way. God did not want the sacrifices required by the law of Moses. Everybody understand that? God had never planned for the old system here to be the final system. Instead, he provided a new way, a new covenant through who? Through Christ.
Amen.
Who obeyed God and willingly gave up his life as a perfect sacrifice. Christ cancels the first covenant, this covenant, amen? In order to establish the second one. Everybody with me?
Amen.
Setting aside the first system in order to establish a far better one meant doing away with the system of sacrifices contained in the ceremonial law. It didn't mean eliminating God's moral law contained in the Ten Commandments.
Amen.
Everybody with me?
Amen.
The ceremonial law prepared people for Christ with his coming. That system was no longer needed. This system, the Holy of Holies, the Ark, the tabernacle.
Amen.
Everybody got it? Go back to me to verse 11. We're almost there. Y'all enjoying this?
Yes.
Yes. Amen. Y'all's foundation in Christianity will never be the same.
Amen.
When you praise God, you begin to think about Jesus Christ, you think about Him as your Lord and Savior, you're going to understand why He had to come to the earth to fulfill that which we couldn't fulfill. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And to please the anger God had against sin. That's why flesh cannot glory in the presence of God. Hallelujah. If you have unconfessed sin and try to come in and worship a holy God, and you're wondering why there's no fellowship here, because there's unconfessed sin. Sin cannot be in the presence of a holy God.
Amen.
Right.
You have to go through the right atonement, which through the blood. Through the blood of who? Not animals or goats or calves. Don't bring your sacrifice shed animals in here. How do you know? A lot of witchcraft mimic that.
Yes.
The cutting of blood and the shedding of blood all over the places. That's witchcraft. The devil's always trying to copy God.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. There's only one that shed the blood, Jesus Christ. The devil's always trying to be like Christ, or trying to be better, or trying to pull you away from some other sacrifice that he offers. Amen?
Amen.
The only one sacrifice. Verse 11. Under the old covenant. The old covenant. Now we understand what the old covenant means. The priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins. But our high priest, Jesus Christ, offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand, because he was done. 13. There he waits until his enemies are humbled and made a footstool under his feet. Y'all go find out what that means. For by that one offering he forever made perfect us, those who are being made holy. We're being made holy. Everybody understand that? That's sanctification. That when we first come into the body of Christ, how many knows that we're holy by the resurrection, by receiving salvation, by receiving the Spirit of God, we come alive through the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
We're born again. We're transformed from the inside. But then now the Holy Spirit's job is to continue to what? Make us holy. So each of us, cutting away of old things, producing new things. Amen? Everybody understand that?
Amen.
That's the process that the church doesn't tell a lot of saints. So when they come in, they stick around, they don't understand what's happening. There's a great shaking going on with that little tree. They don't understand what's all the shaking going on in their lives. There's a cutting away of dead flesh, old habits, old things, producing of new fruit in that Christian's life. They run. I'm not used to this. Or if they come into this ministry, they're used to eating junk food. They come in here. Oh, you guys are too critical in here. Y'all are condemning. Y'all judging. No, you're not used to the Word of God.
Amen.
You're used to eating junk food. This is heavy meat. You guys are used to eating steak and potatoes. You go sit somewhere else and eat fried and junk food. You're going to know.
Yeah.
There's no Spirit of God in here in this place. Where's the move of God? Where's the Holy Ghost? Where's the Word of God? Amen?
Amen.
When you exalt Jesus, Jesus Christ said, when I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me.
Amen.
When Jesus Christ and Him crucified is exalted, the Holy Ghost then begins to move.
Amen.
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 No cross, no Jesus, no Holy Ghost. How many know that?
That's right.
Everything points to Christ. So I don't know what they're preaching in the pulpit. Yeah, it's beyond me. Okay, verse 13. Are we there? Verse 15, actually. Oh, this is going to be good. We're almost there, saints. We got a few more scriptures and we're done. And the Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so, that we're being made holy. For he says, this is the new covenant I will make with my people on that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their what? Hearts. I will write them on their minds. Then he says, I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds. Once you repent and you ask God to forgive you for whatever it is that you've done, He wipes it away. He washes it away. He completely forgets. That's why the Bible says, Apostle Paul said, forgetting those things of the past and pressing on to the future of the high calling of Christ Jesus. Why? He had a hard time letting go of the past because he killed Christians. How do you think he was able to handle that? Some of us have a hard time letting go of those old things we did. Maybe hurting somebody. Maybe somebody hurt us. We have a hard time forgetting and forgiving. And forgiving yourself. If you have stayed before a holy God and have asked the Lord to forgive you, you know He's convicted your heart on something. You know He's brought conviction to your spirit about something in your life. And you stay there in the presence of God and repent. Some of you may have to stay there a little longer and saturate in His presence. You will feel the forgiveness of God. Amen. The Holy Spirit will come upon you and begin to wash you and begin to cleanse you.
Amen.
In His presence. Amen?
Amen.
It's guaranteed, saints.
Hallelujah.
It's guaranteed. And you know what, saints? It's free. You don't have to pay nothing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on, get tithes and offerings out of your mind. That's not what I'm talking about. Religious folks out there. Come on now. Some of y'all need to take y'all's halos off. Lay it down. You're not that holy.
Amen.
There's only one that's holy, that's Jesus, and we're being perfected in that holiness. Means that we're not being perfect, we're being matured into that holiness. Everybody understand that?
Amen.
You come, you make yourself better, you don't condemn yourself. Forgive yourself as Christ forgave you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You melancholies. We'll get to that in a minute. Gotta forgive yourself, melancholy. Y'all hold on to some stuff, boy. Y'all hold on till Jesus comes. Now, I know in 1965. The only one that can remove that unforgiveness or that sin or that guilt or that shame is the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
No other thing can do it. I can be in the presence of God repenting. What are you repenting from? None of your business. I'm repenting before the Lord, and I'm there. I don't know, maybe 5 minutes sometimes. And I'm washed. Maybe a half hour. I don't leave the presence of God until He releases me. You're done, son. I don't know how long I'm going to stay there when I go into the presence of God. There's not a time capsule put on it. You, it's between you and the Father. When
Amen.
You go in, it's
right.
your time. The more you stay, though, doing it, the longer your time will expand. You won't want to leave. Then you'll get to a place and say, Lord, I'm not ready to go back into the natural yet.
Amen.
I want to stay in here in the supernatural. Because we worship Him in what? In spirit and in truth. Can't worship Him in your flesh. It's a Holy Spirit experience. You worship God with your spirit man that's been resurrected. And who helps you to worship Him? The Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Though you know not what to say sometimes, it says the Spirit of God will speak through you with words you can't even utter. Sometimes you won't have the right words. You may be going through such heavy trials or heavy temptations where you're ready just to be, I'm ready to give up, Lord. I'm done. I'm going to go back. And you're in the presence of God. You don't know what to say. That's why we say the baptism of the Holy Ghost is so important for the Christian. It gives you power over the flesh, the devil, and the world.
Hallelujah.
You're praying, Lord, I need to see if I'm going there. I'm so heavy and stricken and laden with trials and temptation. How many know temptation brings heaviness?
Amen.
When you're being tempted, it's not that you're in sin. There's no sin in temptation. Remember that,
Amen.
Saint? There's only sin when you yield and give over to that temptation. But there is a heaviness and pressure that comes through that temptation that you got to endure.
Amen.
And you can only do it through the presence of God. You're in there, you're in there, you're in there, and all of a sudden, it's gone.
Amen.
And you don't even understand. You're like, Lord, it's in the spirit. I don't know what to pray for. I can't pray against this thing. My mind is racked with trials and temptations. I'm getting bombarded with all this mess to go drink, go fornicate, go do all this. To hold that person with anger, emotional, whatever's going on. You don't have the right prayers to come out. So what do you do? After about 5 minutes praying in tongues, all of a sudden, thank you, Lord. Praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you. Father, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. No weapon formed against me shall prosper in the name of Jesus. Satan, I command thee to get behind me in the name of Jesus. For the Lord shall deliver the godly out of temptation. It starts to flow.
Amen.
But how many knows we have to break through that fleshly part of us? Amen?
Amen.
That's where tongues come in. That's why the Bible says the Holy Spirit will help you. It's a spiritual experience. Amen?
Amen.
So, but for now, we've got to carry around this carcass. Hallelujah. This flesh hasn't been redeemed, all right? So every day, you're going to be given a fleshly desire. You just cast down that vain imagination, the Bible says.
Amen?
As soon as it comes in, cast it down. Some of y'all got to learn how to cast down those thoughts. Y'all haven't come to that place. Start dwelling on them. Start meditating on them. Start fooling with them. You know they're not of God. It'll start to what? Get down into your heart.
That's right.
It'll start to contaminate your faith. Then eventually you're going to go and what? Put your hand to it and start doing it. It's all right here, see? That's why we have to be sanctified. Renewing us a right mind and a right spirit. Right mind first. Then a right spirit through the washing and the watering of God's word. Hallelujah. Why? Because the mind is enmity against God.
That's right.
It never wants to please God. So the mind hasn't been resurrected. Hallelujah. We're still in this enmity mind. So it has to be washed what? Daily. Hallelujah. Not every Sunday. If you're waiting till Sunday to get your wash on, man. Woo! By the time you come in, you're going to be like this. I made it, Pastor. Hey, you made it. Praise God. You made it, right?
Amen.
But I'm trying to show you how to live a victorious life through the week.
Yes.
So that when you come in here, you're coming in here with joy in your spirit because you whipped the devil in your life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on, yeah.
Glory to God.
Yes.
That's that's cause for a glory. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
It says here in verse 19, we're going to finish up here, saints. Did I say that already four times? Or three times? Verse 19 through 22, we're done. That's it. Promise you. Last closing. And so, dear brothers and sisters, Apostle Paul, we can boldly enter into heaven's most holy place because of what? The blood of Jesus. He says you can boldly, saint, come into the Holy of Holies. He's telling the Jews, the Hebrews, he's Apostle Paul giving them, hey, you can come in boldly into the Holy of Holies. You don't have to be scared that God's going to reject you, that God's going to condemn you, that God's going to bring some kind of judgment or punishment upon you. If you come in through the blood and repent and say, Father, forgive me, he will wash you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Amen?
Amen.
Come on now. By his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. How many knows this curtain right here? This was the veil that separated the holy from holies. Amen? The holy place from the holy of holies. This is where God's presence was resting in this place so nobody could get to it. It was barred from man. Amen? Now Jesus made a way for us to go through the curtain into the most holy place. He, when Jesus died, it said the curtain was torn. Remember that?
Yes.
This was torn.
Amen.
That means that the way that was closed off from man was now open to all
Amen.
Men. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because of Jesus Christ. His Amen. Sacrifice made a way where it seemed to go be no way to go back to the Father. Everybody with me? Almost there. And since we have a great high priest, our Lord Jesus Christ, who rules over God's house, his heavenly house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting Him. For our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean. Our bodies have been washed with pure water. Close your books.
Amen.
We got through it. We got through it. Hallelujah. So your foundation in Christianity will never be the same. You got to remember one thing, believers. The Bible says in the last days that they will not endure sound doctrine. How many knows when you come in here and you're listening to this kind of word, there is some endurance that has to take place in your life when you come into this kind of teaching.
Amen.
There's some endurance. Those who don't want to endure, they'll go find something that will tell them what their itching ears want to hear. My whole reason for sharing this is because of what's going on in the church house today is what the preachers are telling them, what their itching ears want to hear. Who doesn't want to say that the Ten, or we are here that the Ten Commandments have been done away with? We're under grace. We're not under the law anymore. What does that give the Christian? A license to sin. God forbid. How would you want to serve a living God and still want to live in sin? And how many knows there's consequences in that sin? But for you here, stand.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I raging sea. I have this blessed assurance.